your service on a Sunday. We have the baptistry full today, and that means that God is at work. That means that his promise of seeking and saving the lost is true in many lives, and today we're going to celebrate the truth of that in the life of Josiah. And so I just want to explain to you as we open up this service, just thinking biblically about baptism. The scriptures show us Jesus going through his own baptism in obedience. We see in the end of Matthew a declaration and a command for us to go to all the nations and to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's a sign of them being made disciples. And the scriptures also declare that there is a washing and a regeneration that takes place by the Holy Spirit, Titus chapter 1. And baptism becomes a picture of that work that God does in our lives. And so, as we get the chance to have this ceremony this morning, this baptism, for you it's a chance to see an enactment, a mini parable of the saving work of Jesus Christ. That those who put their faith in him are united with Jesus Christ, first in his death. And we go with him to the grave, and the old man is dead. And then a new man is raised to new life in the regeneration that only God can do to take us from darkness to light, from death to life. And so this morning, you're going to see that happen. And we're going to celebrate the fact that God is showing his faithfulness in Josiah's life. And so he has professed his faith in the Lord. We're celebrating that today. And the scriptures say in 2 Corinthians 5:17 that if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. And old things have passed away, and all things have been made new. The new has come. So we just wanted to explain that this morning. I want you to recognize that there is an act of obedience, that there is an act of declaration, that Josiah is willing to stand before this church family and say, I belong to Jesus. And there's also a demonstration of what God does in our hearts. So this morning, I'm just going to invite Justin and Josiah to come into the water here with me. What a joy to have God work in families. So we have Justin is going to baptize his stepson. We're so grateful for the way that you guys have been discipling in your home. You've been sharing the importance of following Christ in all aspects. And the fruit of that is here before us today. And so, Justin, I'm just going to let you take over from here, bud. We're here to celebrate with you as a church body. We see God at work. And so now it's you guys' turn. We're going to do this thing together. Yeah. We're just discussing tactics up here. Here's a beautiful thing, guys. The scriptures share a picture of baptism where people of maturity and leadership in the lives of those that come to Christ, they are often the ones that baptize. So you might think of Philip baptizing an Ethiopian. And you know what? It doesn't have to be a pastor, and that's part of what's going on here. So it's a really beautiful thing that Justin and his work in his own home in raising up maturity in Josiah, he gets to be the one doing that this morning. Now, I don't know if you baptized somebody. My first time was not that long ago, but today is, I think, a second for you. And so it's kind of a new thing. We're going to roll this. We're going to do this together. So we're excited. All right.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you, God, that he's willing to stand before all these people and declare that to the world and walk with you in obedience. We pray that you would acknowledge that and walk with him every step of the way, Father, until that great day. And so, Father, would you give him the strength to be a follower of Christ, wherever he may be? Would you give him the integrity to follow according to your commands? Would you just bless this young man and the work of Christ going on in his family and his home? We just commend all of this to you in celebration of your word as we see it enacted today. We love you, Lord. We celebrate your goodness, and all in the name of our great Savior, Jesus Christ. Everybody can say, Amen. Amen.
Go. Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
We can just say amen and go home and praise the Lord, right?
No.
We've got so much more praising and lifting up the name of the Lord today in song and in word. And, you know, we've got a lot of things going on this next week as well. And we want to make sure that everybody knows just exactly what's going on and how you can participate. Before I go any further, I'm going to stop and introduce myself for those that might not know me. My name is Butch. I'm one of the pastor elders here. And it's my great privilege to welcome you here today. And if you are a guest today, welcome. We are so glad you're here, and I hope you feel welcome, because we're just one big family, and we're a welcoming, loving family. And so I hope you feel welcome. And we just want to ask you to do us one favor. Right there in front of you in the pew back there, if you would pull out. There's a card there, and it's labeled a card. If you would fill that out for us, we would love an opportunity to connect with you. It gives us the opportunity to reach out. We'd like you to share a cup of coffee with you or lunch, whatever works out for you. But it's an opportunity for you to get to know us a little better and for us to get to know you a little better. You know, we hate when people can come in here and we say hi to them and we don't really get to know them all that well, and they disappear. Like, wow, I wish I could get a hold of that person and connect. So that's what we're wanting to do with that. So if you would help us with that, and when the offering plate comes by just a little bit later in our service, you can just drop that right in there. That would be awesome. Well, guys, we've been building up to the Texas Mission Group for a lot of weeks now. We've been talking about having folks house them and prepare for them and to work with them. Guess what? It starts tomorrow. They arrive tomorrow. So we're excited. We've got housing for them. We've got that arranged. We've got all the food organization kind of underway. I think we got everything kind of set for that. But one of the things that we've been encouraging everybody is this isn't about them just coming and doing it. We just kind of watch and cheer them on. Way to go, mission team. Yeah. We want you guys to participate. You need to be a part of this. And there's all kinds of activities that are going on this week. And there's a schedule in the back. If you look on the back table back there, there's a stack of these. Grab this and check out the schedule that's going on. And look at the areas where you might be able to participate. We're not asking that you be involved every minute of every hour of every day or whatever, but if you've got some time throughout the week that you can plug in and help out and participate with, this is the schedule. It's there. And there's also these cards you can hand out. They're invites. So there's activities that are going on. We've got some Tuesday through Friday over here at Eastside Park. There's going to be some activities with the kids in the local area. And so we're going to be doing some teaching and just having some fun with them. So that's an opportunity as well. Also, the Calvary student get-together is going to be Friday with the mission team. So they're going to be getting together. And that is this Friday from 6:30 to 9. And it's going to be right here. We're going to start at the church for worship. It's going to be a fun and really a wonderful time of worshiping the Lord together for that. So that's something to look forward to. And then we have the Grow Seminar coming up the following week. So that's coming up on May 28th and 29th. That's a Friday and Saturday. We would like to know if you want to be a part of that. We've had a couple of Grow Seminars already. We've had great attendance. You guys have been awesome. This one is going to be talking about what is the church. So if you want to know a little bit more about that from a history perspective and what is the church and how does that all play together, May 28th and 29th. And we would ask that you'd let one of us know if you're going to come, because we want to make sure we've got enough materials. We print out the materials, and Shauna does such a great job of getting that all organized for us. And when you come in, it kids there at the tables, and we have like assigned seating. Even I have to always look because she moves me around, and I don't know where I'm supposed to be. And the last thing that I'll mention here in the way of announcements, Summer Reconnect. We call it Reconnect. Normally we call it Summer Connect, but last year we didn't get a chance to connect. We had that silly COVID thing going around, and it kind of prevented us from getting together. But this year, we're going to reinvigorate that, and we're going to call it Summer Reconnect. And so if you've got things that you normally do in the summer, and you're thinking to yourself, you know what? I could do that with a bunch of other people. Well, then let us know what it is, when it is, and we'll get it up on the board. We're going to start putting those things up on the board so we got schedules so people know. And the idea is, again, it's not that you go to all, because we don't want to wipe you out and have you exhausted and coming back in here going, I don't have any more energy. No, no. Pick the ones that you can and participate when you can and just go and enjoy and fellowship and praise the Lord together. So that's what we're looking for. If you've got some ideas, I've got some hints that there's going to be an epic s'more night. I also got some hints that somebody, Cheryl and I, are going to be hosting a pinnacle gallery in our house. So there's all kinds of things that are going to be happening. So anyway, that's what we've got going on. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's turn this over to Him. And let's begin to really focus in on what God has for us today. Heavenly Father, You are so awesome. Thank You so much for allowing us to gather together in Christ's name. And to worship, and to know that the one that we worship is seated on His throne in full control over all the chaos that we see going around us, and that we can know peace in the midst of the storm because You are truly in control. Father, we love You. We're grateful for these opportunities, and we pray that our worship for You today would be pleasing, would honor You, and bring glory to Your holy name. And we give these things to You. We trust this service to You, and we pray that Your Holy Spirit will be in our midst. We give You the glory, the honor, and the praise in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. You stand as we enter into worship. Let's just take a moment. Let's quiet our hearts for a second. Just kind of ask the Holy Spirit just to draw you in. This is our opportunity for us to worship the Lord. For Him to speak to us. So let's just put things aside and let Him come and just feel His presence here this morning.
Loving us to your grave.
Changes the way of the conversation. We got to go to my daughter's graduation this weekend. And, you know, graduations, the big question is always, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? What's next? A lot of talk about achieving things and big dreams. And Amy and I, we were talking last night, and we were just talking to each other and saying, you know what, that's the wrong question. It's too centered on self. The big question is, how are you going to glorify God?
Amen.
What are you going to do with God? How are you going to bring glory to His name? You know, the first question in the Westminster Confession is, what's the chief end of man? That's the first question because it's the most important question. What is your life about? And we talk to these young people, and we talk so much about career, goals, and marriage, and all these things. And the most important thing is God and giving glory to God. There's a lady by the name of Mary Brown. She was just a simple school teacher. But I think she kind of got it. She understood that life is not just about a career or about a family. But it was about, how do I give glory to God? She's part of a Baptist church. And she loved to write. She wrote a song called I'll Go Where You Want Me to Go. It's interesting because it's kind of a mission song, and when you realize it, she never went anywhere. You realize that she got it. Because we say it a little bit differently, but this is really what it's all about, to make God not ignorable wherever we are. Here, halfway around the world, right? So I want to teach you this song. Because I think it plays into what God's doing in our church about making Him not ignorable, right? So just sing along. You'll learn it's pretty easy. Some of us, to even go to different places. Thank you, Lord God, for your grace and your mercy. Let us make much of you and enjoy you, Lord. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Have a seat, Colonel. The psalmist tells us that the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. So, as we grow as disciples, we realize everything we see, even our own self, belongs to Him. And because of that, He is the owner of all things, but He's the ruler and the one who loves like no one else. And so, I just want to remind you of that truth from the Psalms. We're going to continue in kind of a mode of prayer as we enter into our time of giving, because our giving is connected to something. It's given so that there may be those who are doing the work of the kingdom that may have that opportunity to continue on with their work. And so I just want to remind you that there's a board in the hallway back here, and there's one in the office as well that reminds us of some of the people that we are privileged to connect with across borders and in different cultural contexts. And we want to be people who uphold them in prayer, as well as uphold them financially, as well as seek to see Jesus glorified through their work. So I just hope that your hearts are there with us in that. And we're going to have a time of prayer again and just remembering some of those missionaries. So would you bow your heads with me, and then we'll spend some time worshiping God in our giving. Father, as we bow once again, we've been in a mode of singing songs to you, praising you for who you are, recognizing your glory and wanting to glorify because you are great and worthy of great praise. Father, in these moments as a body, we would bow our heads and join in partnering in the gospel, even in this labor of prayer. Father, for our brothers and sisters serving on the team in South Asia, for Ian and Haley and their family, we lift them to you today, Lord. Would you give them strength? Would you give them health? Would you give them divine opportunities to represent you and to represent you with joy and wisdom? With discernment in right times and ways. Give them words when they need it, Lord. Build their team. Father, we pray that you would be at work in La Carpio, where the Sears family is serving the poor, and we just pray that there would be much grace poured out through their hands, through their feet, through their acts of kindness and goodness to those around, so that Jesus, it can be seen the character of who you are. We pray that their ministry would be fruitful. Father, we pray also for the work going on in Mozambique. Pray for safety in the times where there is challenge and strain and danger. And Lord, would you bless the MAF pilots that are serving there? Would you give them sustenance, both spiritually and physically? Would you give them perseverance and your protection? Father, there are many others, and we can continue on, but for now, Father, with these lifted before you specifically and others on our hearts and minds, would you lead us to be a people who participate in holding your name up, to be seen, to be known, to be recognized as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So our giving, we want to be for you, Lord. Would you bless this time? And each amount that's given, Father, multiply it, use it, bless it. Let it be placed in the right place at the right time so that your work can continue. This we pray with joy and anticipation in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Brown and be dismissed for Calvary Kids class. Please join me as we read God's Word. Our passage today will be 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 9, which can be found on page 578 of the Black Pew Bibles. If you need a Bible, please take this one out of the pew and take it home with you and consider it a gift from us. Again, the passage today is 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty, for people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness, but denying its power. Avoid such people. For among them are those who creep into households and capture weak women, burdened with sins and led astray by various passions, always learning and never able to arrive at a knowledge of the truth. Just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, so these men also oppose the truth, men corrupted in mind and disqualified regarding the faith. But they will not get very far, for their folly will be plain to all, as was that of those two men.
Good morning once again. As we begin, I just want to tell you guys I love you. It's good to be together in community. It's good to do what we do here, which is open the Word of God and let it speak. If you're new to us, we like to go through the Scriptures, passage by passage, and just take the full counsel of God and try to present that. There are blessings and challenges with that. We come to passages that are harder, and we don't skip over them. We come to passages that are more joyful, and we celebrate those just as well. If you heard that list just read, you might be going, okay, we got a real upper today. But we're gonna look at God's Word together and let Him speak and let Him describe the world that He's made and how it works, and trust that He's got something to encourage us and to help us along. So let's just say a word of prayer at the beginning here. We need the Lord to do His work in us, so let's ask Him for that. Father, one more time we approach. We're in and out of prayer, we're in and out of worship, but this short moment of prayer, we would just together share a request that God, You, by Your Spirit, would speak truth to us. We want to know what's true. We want it to shape us. We want to be affected by it. We want to know who we are and how things really work. So God, this is an appeal for your hand to be upon us in the preaching of Your Word. Let it be for Your glory, that all can see Jesus Christ on display today. It's in that great name we pray. Amen. Well, let me give you a preview of what we're going to do here with these verses. We're going to be in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. And I want to give you kind of the big idea that I think is going on here, share with you kind of the three sections of how we'll work through this, and just kind of take that journey together. Here's a statement I want us to kind of work with this morning. True-born realism is a safeguard for the genuinely God-centered soul. Let me say that again. True-born realism is a safeguard for the genuinely God-centered soul. I want to speak about this passage and share some details about it to try and help you see that I think that there's a message along these lines for us. That there's a realism being presented to us here as a safeguard for a soul that's supposed to be God-centered. So,
what we're going to do is we're going to talk about verses 1 through 5, the beginning of 5. There's something to know. Something to know. And then we're going to talk about verses 5 through 8 because there's something to do. And praise the Lord, as we end up the last bit in verse 9, we're going to see that there's something to be encouraged by. Something to know, something to do, and something to be encouraged by. Very simple. Let's look at it together. So go ahead and look again, chapter 3, verse 1. It says, "But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty." It's a very straightforward statement. It's stated as an imperative, as a command. Paul is saying to Timothy, I want you to understand something. Understand this. Now, if you've been tracking with us, or if you haven't, either way, let me catch you up to how we come to this moment. You see, Paul has been basically coaching Timothy along regarding how to navigate controversy and quarrels. And we know from the immediate context of what we've been reading, as well as from the background of the book of 1 Timothy, that the situation in Ephesus, they were dealing with false teachers. They were dealing with presentation of unhealthy doctrine. And so there were various false teachers and various false teachings going on in this environment. And so for Timothy, Paul is calling him with a pastoral heart to have a very delicate harmony of both avoiding ignorant babble and protecting against quarrelsomeness. That's one side. But at the same time, also teaching and correcting with a Christ-like kindness, gentleness, and patience. Just as David pointed out last week, that we might be winsomely drawing people to the truth as opposed to driving people to it, or maybe even just toward victory for ourselves. So this is kind of what's going on as Paul has been coaching Timothy along. And as he does, he comes into this third chapter and he says, but let me pull back and say this statement, Timothy. With all this going on, understand this. Here's the statement, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. Now, I think it's important that we read carefully here, that we read what Paul is actually saying and what he's not saying. What is the thing that Paul wants Timothy to understand? There's a prepositional phrase, if you want to get back in English class, in the last days, that's qualifying, describing a certain thing. But the statement is this, there will come times of difficulty. And so, as he explains this, and he comes back around to saying, here's an overall reality for you to kind of wrap your mind around, Timothy. I want you to grasp this. When he says understand, he's talking about, I need you to realize, to think, to remember and to know. So this is about knowing something. And the thing he wants it to have is this reality that, you know what, in this world, we've already been talking about these quarrels and the trials and the different difficulties in Ephesus. Timothy, there will be expected times of difficulty. And he says, this will happen in the last days. I'm going to get to that in just a second, but let's define our terms first. Let's first define this idea of difficulty. It's from the idea of reducing strength. That is the kind of thing that takes away, saps your strength. So it's that kind of thing that's hard to bear or hard to take as an ongoing thing. That's what the word in Greek is telling us. There will be times that will sap you. They will be so hard to bear. It's not necessarily like a passively, it's just going to be happening. It can mean harsh or fierce or savage. There's another use of this where Matthew, in his gospel, he's the only other New Testament writer to use this same word, and he uses it to describe two demon-possessed men as fierce. When we say that these times are going to be difficult, it's not just a passive like, oh, we're falling on hard times. No, these are fierce times, savage things that will drain you and wear on you. You need to know this. And yes, he does have this qualifier that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. Let's talk about that for a moment. First of all, I want you to notice that what Paul is not saying is, I want you to understand the last days. Do you see the distinction there? He's saying that in the last days, this is going to happen. So his message is about the difficulty. And he's just saying it's going to be happening in the last days. Now, I looked this up this week to try and understand this usage. And there are five usages of last days, plural, in the New Testament. Five times is that kind of a phrase used. And I want to look at those because I want us to understand what period of time he may be talking about. You may hear this and go, are we approaching the last days? Is something coming? Acts chapter 2, verse 17 is one of those instances. And Peter is standing up in the wake of God moving and putting his spirit in them. And they are sharing the glories of God in all kinds of languages. And the world around is taking notice and saying, are you hearing this? We're hearing the glories of God in our own tongues by these uneducated men. And Peter takes that moment, filled with God's Spirit, to speak. He quotes the book of Amos, and he says, Acts 2:17, in the last days, there's the phrase, it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. You see what Peter's doing? He's saying, what you're seeing take place today with the pouring out of God's Spirit is what the Old Testament prophet Amos was telling us would happen. And so in the last days, this is going to take place. Now, what does that mean for us on a timeline? They, at that time, were experiencing what the scriptures in the Old Testament were saying was the beginning of the last days. Let me give you another example. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. He opens the letter. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in, here it is again, these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, who he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. Do you see? The writer of Hebrews at that time is saying he has spoken to us in these last days by his Son. James chapter 5 is another instance, verses 1 through 3. He's warning the rich, and he says, come now, you rich, weep and howl for the miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches have rotted, and your garments are moth-eaten, and your gold and silver have corroded, and their corrosion will be evidence against you, and will eat your flesh like fire. You have laid up treasure in the last days. Now, how can James write that to an audience about their current circumstances of chasing wealth instead of God in the last days if it's yet to come? So, for the most part, what we see is that the usage of the last days seems to indicate that not only are we in the last days, but that started when Jesus came and inaugurated the kingdom of God. Do you remember his message? The kingdom of God is at hand. So repent and believe. When Jesus showed up, the beginnings of that were here. And as God led the earth through its redemptive history into this stage, one way to characterize the age that began when Jesus showed up on the scene and continued when he began the church and we're living in now is that they are the final epic, the last days. Does that make sense? Does that help? So Paul is speaking to Timothy saying we're in this. Now, is that to say that there's not more yet to come? Of course not. There's much more in the scriptures. You'll notice that this is a plural reference. But later in other parts of the scriptures, it'll say on that day. Or the day of the Lord shall come. There is a day, a final day, that is yet to come. And we are marching steadily towards that under God's guidance and his work of redemptive history. So as Peter preached in Acts, and as Paul teaches here, and as James taught, and the writer of Hebrews, all of these are different authors, all saying, here, right now, pay attention because what you're living in can be characterized as this final epic. So I just wanted to explain that because I don't want us to think that Paul is saying, now understand the last days. He's not giving a teaching on the details of that. There's other places for that. That's not our passage today. He's saying, understand that in this age that we're living in, what you should expect is that there will be times of difficulty. So, then he goes on from verse 1 and he says, he gives us a because. For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power. Now friends, that's a mouthful. And it's not exactly the kind of stuff that you get a list like this and you walk out feeling amped up. You look at this and you go, that's a heavy load, Paul. But Paul is saying that the reason that things will be difficult is because people will be like this. Did you notice that? How does the difficulty, how will you be dreaming? What will the environments of the world be like? It'll be like the kind of place where people will be living like this, and that's going to be a drain on those who want to love God. That's going to be a difficult thing for us. So there's reasoning. Each of these sections that we're going to talk about, not only does he give his statement, but he backs it up with reasoning. There will be times of difficulty because this is going to characterize people. Now, it's tempting for me as a preacher to keep us moving along and say, this is just a long list, and it's going to be bad stuff, and let's see what else he has to say. In fact, I read some commentaries that did that. I said, well, time and space doesn't... I think that we should pay attention to how this was written and why it was written. This is what some would call a vice list. There are some 23 lists of vices, of sins, in the New Testament. And out of the list, this one is the longest. It takes up more verses, four verses, and it has more items in the list, depending on how you count it, between 18, 19, 20. I'm calling it 20, how we divide it up. 20 items. Now, Paul, why are you taking this much time with this many words and wasting that much pen and ink when you write just a short letter and now you've given four whole verses this long to just list out the qualities of those that will be around in this time? I think that's a question we need to be asking ourselves. And so let's go through this briefly. I'm not going to preach a sermon on each word, but I want us to understand what's going on here and recognize a few details. As he opens up, he says, here's how things are going to be. They're going to be difficult because people are going to be lovers of themselves. And to be honest, I believe that this is like the mother sin, the root sin, the father sin, the foundation of what's going on here. Because when we decide to exchange a love for ourselves over the love of our Maker, all kinds of fallout happens. All kinds of sin. And the word here is used just here. It's phileo. It's like that brotherly love. It's saying, I have affection for, and it's me, truly, self. So this is about being, not just having concern for my day-to-day. This is about being utterly self-centered. This is about narcissism. This is about love for self. And something we're going to note as we go through here is that on this vice list, you'll find a lot of parallels or overlap with a vice list that we also know from Romans chapter 1, verses 29 to 31. Many of these are the exact same words that Paul is using there. And what's he doing in Romans 1? He's opening up the reality of the gospel, that generally, in all places, for all people, this is the situation of mankind, that they have exchanged the glory of God for a lie. They have put themselves on the throne instead of the God who made them. It's the original sin. It's Satan himself saying, I should be God. And it's the same thing that Adam and Eve were so prone to. The knowledge of God. And it was a pursuit of self. A love of self. Now he says lovers of self, self-lovers, but also lovers of money. Paul did some good exegetical work writing to Timothy in the first letter, talking about the love of money, the way that it can be a root of all kinds of evil. And isn't it interesting that loving self and loving stuff go hand in hand, don't they? Next, he talks about being boastful or proud. And this really is, that the word here is it means talking big. It's like going over the top. You know what that's like? When somebody's just got nothing but themselves to talk about, they're so boastful, it doesn't even really represent reality, they're just over the top. That's what that means, boastful. That word is in the Romans list. Next, he talks about arrogant. And those are, of course, related. But arrogant, the word is meaning high-minded, superior. It has to do with being above and over. And our sense of self-view is not based in reality. It's based on a fabrication in our own mind. Proud and arrogant. The next word is abusive. If you looked at the word in Greek, you'd probably think you know the word because it's blasphema. It's like our word blaspheme. You see, the word here is to curse or to slander, to have verbal contempt for. And it's not just, we usually use blaspheme as something against God. But the word generally used is saying there's a slandering or cursing of the character of whoever. And that's why it's talking about being abusive, verbally, in our language, abusive. Next, he pulls one right off the Ten Commandments, disobedient to parents. This is that sense of like a full, like a conscious disregard for, I don't need that guidance. And isn't it interesting, that one also is on the Romans list. That as Paul describes humanity in its fallen state, as he unpacks this doctrine of sin and the way that it works, disobedience to parents is a sign of something deeper. It's a sign of a rejection of authority. It's a sign that I don't need this. And it has, and it still does, characterize some. Talks about being ungrateful. A lot of these words in the Greek have a negative particle in front of them, just like this one does in English. Ungrateful. So grateful would be the good thing, and being ungrateful is the opposite of that. Many of these words are built that same way in the original language. Instead of the gratitude that is so necessary, just like in Romans 1, I know I'm keeping a parallel here. Just like in Romans 1, they're saying not only did they not know God, but they didn't glorify Him as God. They were not grateful for the gifts of life and breath and everything that we have that comes from His hand. Some have said that ungratitude is one of the highest sins because it rejects the goodness that's given in any case from anybody, especially God. Unholy, again, a negative in front of the other. Instead of holy, instead of the piety of leaning in towards God, of having a duty towards God, all of that's rejected. It's being irreligious. That the forms of trying to know God are all worthless. Let's throw it all out. Unholy. He talks about heartlessness. No affection. That's what that means. No heart. No feeling. Numb. Callous. Also in Romans chapter 1. The next word is unappeasable. This has to do with treaties and not being willing to sign into treaties. You know what that means? They're saying, I'm not willing to agree with anyone on anything. There's no truce here. There's no agreement when there's difficulty. And so the unappeasable is the one who never will come along and sign on and be a part of something. Unappeasable. Nothing will work. Slanderous. You know what that word is? Diabolos. It's the word for the devil. You know why? Because the devil is an accuser. And he stands accusing you and me. He stands accusing everyone. He accuses God himself. And so the word slanderous is about the accusing of. Just like the devil. How about without self-control? Athletes at that time had this quality of control, of discipline, of ability to say the race matters and the work that I'm doing matters. But those who don't have that, the negative of this is to not have the sense of control, domination over self. Brutal. This is about being ungentle, harsh, severe, cruel. The word was used of beasts, especially lions. So when we think of the people that this is describing, there's this sense of just no softness, no kindness. All the things that Paul just told Timothy when he talked about how are you going to get in these conversations and have corrections, he said with gentleness, with kindness, with patience, but not this. This is brutal, fierce, not loving good. You'll recall or you'll know that in the list of qualifications for a pastor. We just read some of it in Timothy's writing, but also in Titus. In Titus, a qualification for overseeing leadership is that they are lovers of good. That the right things are things that they love to affirm and to be about. This is saying they are not lovers of good. Treacherous. You know where this word is used? Judas. the traitor. Handing over. The handing over of Jesus by Judas. The handing over of Jesus by the Jews. Those are the two other uses of the same word that he's saying. This will be a quality of what's going on. Treacherous. Reckless. Reckless has to do with literally falling forward. It's like being headlong, like not even thinking, like just going for whatever. Thoughtlessness. Rash. And he comes again to this idea of self when he talks about conceited. This literally, we've talked about it in our study of 1 Timothy, this literally means puffed up. Like insert gas and inflate. That's why it talks about being inflated with conceit. Lovers of pleasure. You see, this is about the senses. This is about what amuses. This is what about pleases me. And it brings all the way back around. We talked about what is loved at the beginning or not loved. They were lovers of self and lovers of money. Now we're talking about not loving good and loving pleasure instead of loving God. We just heard it. Kelly mentioned it a moment ago. What were you made for? You were made to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. And yet these and those who are just like them from Romans chapter 1 describing the whole world building up to this time into these days that we're living in now of the church age inaugurated by Jesus Christ. This list Paul wants us to soak in and to recognize and to say this is how it is characterized. They may appear godly. Look at verse 5. Having the appearance of godliness, but denying its power. This isn't just not understanding its power. This is saying, I don't want that power. It is a literal pushing away of the dunamis, the power, the dynamite of God Himself. All they want is the shape, is the form. They just want to look a certain way. An appearance of godliness. Now, as I go through that list, you might think, man, did I find a church with an angry pulpit-pounding preacher? It's not my list, first of all. But what do we do with this? You see, Albert Barnes, one commentator, says this, it's much easier for men to observe the forms of religion than to bring the heart under its controlling influence. See what's going on there? They have the appearance of godliness, but they deny its power. It's much easier for men to observe the forms of religious activity, token religionism, we could call it. It's much easier to do that than to bring the heart under the controlling influence of what God would have in our lives. And this has been the problem of humanity from the beginning. This list represents nothing new. Don't think that we're waiting for like a different set of morality to show up on the scene in the last days that wasn't there before. All through the times since the fall in Genesis chapter 3, humanity has lived like this. The scriptures are only describing to us the reality that it's only going to get worse. It's going to characterize what's going on, and that, for those who do want to follow God, is going to create difficulty, challenge, and frustration. I want you to notice in this list the prevalence of love. What is loved or not loved? Because, guys, that's where this is at. It's about the heart. And when we read through this list, I can't even do it in one breath. I tried this week. I was going to try and just hammer the whole thing in one breath. It's that long and that big. What a disturbing recipe this is. I want you to think about this. What would a society be like that was nothing but this? Selfishness, money chasing, pride, arrogance, abusiveness, disobedience, ungratitude, no holiness, heartlessness, no way to be appeased, slander left and right, no self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, conceited, lovers of pleasure, not loving God, faking it. What if that was it? There was no other qualities there. My friends, the removal of all of God's goodness and the distilling down to nothing left but what's without and what's outside of God, pure evil, that's hell. Do you know that? the absence of God's face turned in his goodness. And so this list should make us at least like shudder for a moment and consider. I often think of the Switchfoot lyric, "Is this the world you want? You're making it. Every day you're alive." So we could go back through this list and talk about the opposites. Because if this is a list of what characterizes this world, this godlessness that's going to increase and is, shouldn't we as believers also be looking then, what should the world be like of God-likeness? Loving others instead of self, not loving money. Humble instead of proud or arrogant. Gentle instead of abusive. Obedient to parents. Full of gratitude all the time. Holiness, a piety towards God. Having heart that cares, that sees people in their eyes. Isn't callous, but warm towards those around us. Willing to make agreements and work with people and have discussions instead of being unappeasable. Instead of accusing all the time, falling on our knees before the throne saying, "Have mercy on me, O God, a sinner." Having a sense of control. That when things come up, I have, in Spanish we call it domino propio, like a dominance over self. Gentleness instead of brutality. Loving good things. Instead of being treacherous and handing over and always trying to trip someone up, how about working for their good, for their success, for their spiritual well-being? Instead of being rash, using our heads and our hearts in conjunction with God's word and his spirit. Not being puffed up, but being brought low. Not loving amusements and trivialities and all kinds of pleasures. But being lovers of God. Wouldn't you want that to be your epitaph? This one is a lover of God. At the one end of the list is lover of self, and everything that falls out from it. At the other end of the list, if we work it backwards, as if we were lovers of God, we could work it just the reverse. So, the world that we're in is composed of all kinds of people, and Paul is saying, I want you to understand this. I want you to understand. Now, what's the point of making sure Timothy knows? Why is he saying, I want you to know this, Timothy? Well, I've been thinking this week about the concept of a police sketch artist. You know what they do? They sit down and they listen to somebody describe someone that they saw, a suspect of some sort, and they give various cues and details about the person. And then the sketch artist works to receive those clues, those descriptions, and sketch it all out to make a composite view so we can recognize what we're looking for. Friends, I believe that's what Paul is doing here. He has given attention to give lots of description and detail to give us a composite view so you can recognize what we're looking for. So the point of making sure that Timothy knows is, number one, that he wouldn't be surprised by it. Don't be surprised by it. Don't let it throw you off. Don't let it put you in a funk or get you off your game or say, oh no, everything's unraveling right before us. No, he said, it'll happen and it will cause difficulty. So don't be surprised by it. But see, with this idea of creating such a detailed sketch, I believe Paul is also saying, don't be seduced by it. Don't be surprised by it. Don't be seduced by it. So that moves us into what he says next. Because we've talked about something to know. Now we need to have something to do. You see, at the end of the list, he says one short sentence, three words, avoid such people. The word here means to turn away. Now, we have to grapple with this. And I hope that you do. I hope you don't hear this and go, hurrah, I've just been given license to like turn my back on every bad person I've ever met. If you're reading your scriptures and you love Jesus, there's going to be some tension here. You're going, what do you mean, avoid such people? What do we do when the scriptures remind us that we ourselves were once slaves to the same things? That this could be a description of any one of us before we met Jesus, before he stepped into our lives and decided to make us new by his great work. So avoid such people. We must continue to remember that others can be set free if they would put their hope fully in Jesus Christ and him, his alone, his grace alone. But I believe this is a good moment to remember our context. He says avoid such people, and as I described in the introduction, remember that this is a time when it's not just random Joe or random Susie saying some things, it's false teachers are infiltrating the church and leading people astray. That's the concern in Paul's mind as he says, listen, when you see this composite sketch, it looks like this. Watch out. That's his warning. Turn away from that. And it has much to do with not being led astray. Here's how I know that. Let's read on. Avoid such people because, here's the statement of reason that I said was there, because among them, out of this group of just this general statement, we have a general state described in the first five verses, and now he speaks of a specific situation. Among them are some, find my spot again, among them are those who creep into households and capture weak women, burdened with sins and led astray by various passions. He's saying there are some who are specifically trying to lead you astray. And he talks about sneaking into households. Some versions say worm their way into households. It's this picture of coming in undetected, purposefully, slyly. It's almost a call back to Genesis 3 when a serpent that we might recall shows up on the scene with words of deception. And friends, the reality of it from Genesis 3 is still maybe part of what's going on in this situation. That serpent approached Eve, and that serpent appealed to certain senses of hers. If you'll remember in Genesis chapter 3, it says, so when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Now, some people accuse Paul of being really hard, harsh on women and having old views and whatnot. And he says that they capture weak women. It's a diminutive form of the word for women. It just means little women, and it's not meant to be an insult. It's meant to say that there were some who were in a situation in Ephesus who were falling prey to this stuff. They weren't in a place of strength. And it's the same kind of appeal to the same sort of draw that Eve fell to in Genesis chapter 3. Appealing to those senses. And listen, here's the thing. Men, the reason that this is a problem is that if someone is approached and there's a hook with something that sounds pleasurable or interesting or neat or curiosity of some sort, and then that's brought into your household and you're standing idly by and you don't even know that it's going on, the blame is there in the whole household. Paul would write to Titus and talk about in chapter 1, verse 11, that there are some who are upsetting entire families. And that's what Paul's concern is here. Because when he describes the victim, talks about this weakness, talks about this burden, they have sins loaded down in their life. And they're dominated by those passions and driven left and right by ungodly things, and therefore just as susceptible to this deception. Always learning and never able to arrive at a knowledge of the truth. One commentator says, it certainly does describe them, these women, as being dominated by curiosity, novelty, and self-centeredness. When we're always learning but never able to come to a knowledge of the truth. Paul then uses this example in verse 8, just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, so these men also oppose the truth. Men corrupted in mind and disqualified it regarding the faith. When we think about this deceiving, when we think about how this might work, I want to give a few examples of what that could look like biblically to help our biblical literacy as well as in our own times. One, calling the philosophy of the month club. You can go to Acts chapter 17 and recall Paul in Athens, the center of Greek philosophical thinking. And he's there to exchange ideas. In Acts 17:21 says, "Now all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there would spend their time in nothing except telling or hearing something new." You see, when you're caught up in, just tell me something interesting, what's the latest internet buzz, when it's the philosophy of the month club, and you're right in line for somebody to come along and say, yeah, there's a lot of learning going on, but there's no knowledge of the truth. Philosophy of the month club. Or how about this potential pitfall? Bible study merry-go-round. The Bible study merry-go-round. We just study and study and study. We love getting in the Word. We congratulate ourselves for how much we read the Word. And yet nothing ever changes. There's no growth. And Jesus warned in John chapter 5, verse 39, to the Pharisees, who knew the Scriptures better than probably any of us will, "You diligently study the Scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life. Yet these are the Scriptures that testify about me. And yet you refuse to come to me to have life." You see the merry-go-round? You see what can happen when we just are infatuated with learning and ideas, but we're not infatuated with truth. Does anybody here want to know the truth? We do. The last one I'll say is more of a modern one, Oprah-style pop spirituality. It's the latest book. It's the, this is popular because, it's folk theology made from our own images of our own thinking of what God should be like. I would like a God like that. God has introduced himself to us, my friends. He will tell us what he's like, and anything we need to know, he has written. Amen. So we don't need to be falling prey to the latest, hey, read this book, I had it on the show, it's super interesting, even if it's cloaked in spirituality. Men, do you know what your wives are into? Wives, you're watching your hearts not to be like this kind. Because Paul is saying, here's a composite view. This is what this looks like, and we need to look for it. He says, avoid that. Watch out for it. We've got to wrap up, so the last thing is that there's something to encourage. Isn't that good news? Everybody look and read verse 9 with me. Despite all this going on, it says, "But they will not get very far, for their folly will be plain to all, as was that of those two men." The two men are Jannes and Jambres. You're going to look through the whole scriptures looking for their names, and you won't find them. They're only here. We understand from Jewish writings and from the writings of the early fathers that these were probably the two magicians that Moses faced down when he was in Exodus, telling Pharaoh to let my people go. Maybe you'll recall, he threw down his staff and it became a snake. You're like, yeah, that'll show them that God's at work. And they're like, oh yeah, we can do that too. And they threw down their staffs and made them snakes. Now, why would that be an example here? He's using these guys as an example because note two things. It says that they oppose just like these men do. There is an opposition to the truth. When Moses is trying to show that the true God is at work, they're saying, yeah, I can fabricate something too. And that deception led to the deception of Pharaoh himself. His heart was hardened and he didn't believe. They are opposing the truth of God with things that look like it. But they're not going to get very far. You see, those men may have been able to play stick and snake games. But they couldn't handle the plagues. They couldn't handle the God who can open the sea. They couldn't handle the God of creation. It didn't take long for their fabrication to become obvious to all that it was nothing compared to the power of the living God.
Amen.
So the good news built in all of this, friends, is that yes, you will experience, I will experience, we are experiencing, and the church has experienced difficulty because this is true. But be encouraged. Though there are those who would capitalize on that and profit from that, they're not going to get very far. It will not take long for the truth to shine through. And here's the truth, friends. The truth of the gospel is that there is a knowledge of the truth. When he says knowledge of the truth, you might look back up into chapter 2, verse 25. Correcting opponents with gentleness, God may perhaps grant them repentance leading to knowledge of the truth. You know what that is? That's not an A on a test. That's salvation. The knowledge of the truth is the understanding from the heart, head, mind, all of it together, that Jesus Christ is Lord and that he has come to save us from our sins. He has given his life on a cross as a ransom for many, and that anyone who puts their faith in him can come to a settled knowledge deep in the heart as God opens that understanding to know it. Amen. This is the good news of the gospel, and none of this nonsense can stop God's work. It may be hard. The discussions we have may be difficult because of the environment that is created by more of this kind of stuff, this anti-God, not loving good, not loving anything but themselves and loving pleasure. But God can cut through it with the light of the gospel. And if you're sitting in this room and you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you can say amen because you've experienced it. Amen. One page later in Titus chapter 3, he says, to speak evil of no one, to avoid quarreling, to be gentle, to show perfect courtesy towards all people. Why should we behave that way? Well, number one, is this the world you want? You're making it. But number two, he says, for we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated and hating one another. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us. Not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing and regeneration of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Do you see? That list represents you and it represents me. It represents the world around. The only hope is that God would shine light to save us from this. E.W. Tozer talks about the danger of self. I wanted to read a long quote, and I'm looking at the clock, and I won't. But if you're curious, I can tell you about it later. He talks about the self sins that create a veil. You may be saying, how come I can't come to God? How come I don't see and understand this stuff? Is self on the throne? Have you brought the self sins of self-love and self-sufficiency and all these things, have you brought that to the cross to be killed, that God might be alive in your heart? You see, we need to know and understand this, and we need to avoid it. That's why Paul did the police sketch for us. But the first place to look for it is in your own heart. You'll recognize it because either you do know it right now, that this list characterizes you, or you have been there before. And you know that only God pulled me out from all these various pleasures and passions. So there's three things that come from our 3 points. This is how we sum it up. What do we do with this sketch? It's to understand. Don't be surprised. Don't let your life be thrown into a tizzy because life is harder because of the evil that's around us. Don't let that happen, friends. God knew it was coming. There's a plan. It's in motion. He's sovereign over it all. So understand, avoid, watch out. First watch out in you, then you can watch out in church, and you can watch out in the world. And here's how you're going to watch out. Does it align with what God has already revealed to us through his inspired word? That's why we preach every verse, every chapter. We want you to know the word. Wind and waves, doctrine of all sorts. How will you stay grounded? Know the word, friends. Take it little by little, day by day, but keep it coming into your life and check it with your own heart and mind. So avoid, and then finally hope. Keep your eyes on the Lord. There is an eternal hope that Jesus has opened up for each one who trusts in him. We keep our eyes on the prize. Understand, it's going to be hard. Avoid the deception and stay centered on God's word and live in the hope. It's not going to get very far because God wins. Jesus, we are full of need. The doctrine of sin tells us that we're shot through with it. Not one part of our being is not affected by it. The disease, the rot, the horror of what we did when we exchanged your glory for ours. I pray that you would work to forgive us and to shine light into human hearts so that they can believe the gospel and be saved. I pray that you would work to free us from the old man who's already been crucified for those who are in Christ, and we don't have to live in slavish passions anymore, that we can live in your strength. Loving God and good and all the rest of the opposites of this list. Would you power us for that, Lord? I just ask that you use this preached word somehow as the transcendent God who's also involved and imminent and here to make it alive in us, that we would realize who you are, who we are, and what we're to do about it. Please, God, by your grace and by your mercy, it will be clear that it's all you. So all will be singing and celebrating the great name of Jesus Christ. Thank you for the hope that we have, that you are on your throne. Give us confidence, give us steadiness, and let us live like Jesus people in these days until that great day. In Jesus' name. Well, I hope that despite the long vice list, you have hope. That God has encouraged your hearts today. And the reason, the only reason we can have hope is because of Jesus. We're going to end our service in communion. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, if you cast yourself upon him to receive his mercy and made him Lord of your life, it means you're a Christian, a little Christ, follower of him. And if that's you, then this final moments of coming together at the Lord's table is for you. He wants us to remember how much it costs to redeem us from so great a devastating fall that we created for ourselves. And so he said, as often as you do this, you do it in remembrance of me. If you're here and you don't know what it means to follow Jesus in a relationship, maybe you know what it means to like present religious sort of fronts, if you don't know or you're denying the power of that, let me say two things to you. Number one, in love, skip the communion. Don't worry about that. We dare not want to just play these games a little further before a living God who sees what's going on and he knows your heart anyway. But say that in love. And number two, use this time. As the Bible describes each one of us with such great detail of who we are without Christ, I hope you've seen something of yourself and realize he wants to save you from that. And your option today would be turn to God in repentance and faith. He will save you. So use this time as we just have a brief moment of prayer, a brief moment of meditation for those who are going to take communion. Use this time to search your own heart. And everybody, let's just honor God in our hearts and minds. Let's realize what a terrible state we were in and what a great work it was necessary to save us from that. So bow your heads for a moment, a little bit of music, and then I'll just lead us through the account of the Last Supper, and we'll take that supper together.
Yeah.
your hearts, we come back to the original account that night when Jesus was betrayed, so we can recall what that was like. As they were eating, he took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." Friends, let's take this as Jesus taught us to, just as a way of remembering him, not an empty ritual, but in deep devotion to the living God, his body broken for us. And he took a cup, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for me." Friends, let's take this in remembrance of Jesus Christ. Truly, you are our Savior, God. We honor you as the only mediator between God and man. We honor you as the way, the truth, and the life. We honor you as the living God, clothed in humanity, given up for us. We declare Jesus Christ as Lord. God, help our lives to be ready for the world outside, ready to love those who are just as lost as we were, ready to proclaim that gospel, and always with a wary eye for those who would lead us astray. Give us hope. Give us joy. Thank you that we've been able to remember why we can, because of you, Jesus.
Amen. Let's close this morning by standing, and let's sing the first and third verse again in the song of learning.
Grace of Jesus Christ. Greet one another, meet somebody you haven't met. Have a great week. We love you guys.